HarperCollins presents Reconstruction: How to Rebuild Your Body, Mind and Life After a Breast Cancer Diagnosis by Rosamund Dean. Read by Rosamund Dean. For Jonathan. Introduction. My right breast was not the only thing that cancer took from me. I've also had to reconstruct my entire lifestyle, my mindset, and my identity. Before breast cancer, I was one of those people that never got ill, never went to the doctor, and didn't even like to take a painkiller for a headache if I could help it. I was so certain of my general good health that when I found a lump on my right breast just before Christmas 2020, I felt completely sure that it must be a cyst or some hormonal thing related to having just turned 40. My subsequent diagnosis in January 2021 was a shock. But looking at the statistics, perhaps it shouldn't have been. In 2020, breast cancer had the dubious honour of displacing lung cancer to become the most diagnosed cancer worldwide. Here in the UK, it's also the most common cancer overall, with 1 in 7 women diagnosed in their lifetime. According to statistics from Cancer Research UK, there are around 57,000 new breast cancer cases every year, more than 150 a day, so effectively one every 10 minutes. And it's not merely the realm of the over 50s anymore. Since the early 1990s, breast cancer rates in 25 to 49-year-old women have increased by 17%. It's now the leading cause of death for women aged 35 to 49 in the UK. Let's say that again. It's now the leading cause of death for women aged 35 to 49. When I wrote about my experience of breast cancer treatment in a column for the Sunday Times Style magazine, I was blown away by the response. The column, which was co-written with my husband Jonathan, ran for a year and covered everything from getting through chemotherapy, mastectomy surgery and radiotherapy to how I coped with the psychological trauma of losing my hair and the anxiety about my risk of recurrence. It also dug into the impact on my family, which is why it was so interesting to write alongside Jonathan. I received hundreds of emails and direct messages from readers saying that the column had articulated how they felt and helped them to feel less alone. I found this heartbreaking because a breast cancer diagnosis and the treatment that follows is extremely tough, and no one should ever have to cope with that alone. Isolation was even more prevalent during the COVID pandemic for obvious reasons. I have since learned that there are many resources available, although they're not always easy to find, which is one of the reasons that I wanted to write this book. The good news is that while diagnosis rates are on the rise, breast cancer survival rates are improving and have doubled in the last 40 years. So I know that there are hundreds of thousands of us out there needing warm, relatable advice for getting through treatment and rebuilding ourselves afterwards. This is a pragmatic but positive book for people going through breast cancer and their families and friends. It's a sensible guide, but I've tried to make it optimistic and hopeful, sharing positive advice for breast cancer patients and their supporters while looking forward to a healthy, long life after cancer. If you like, this is the cancer equivalent of one of those pregnancy books with clear advice on what to expect at every stage of treatment and what questions to ask your doctors, right down to what to pack in your hospital bag. Think of it as a guide to what to expect when you're expecting the worst. After writing the column, many readers contacted me asking for advice about their own situation, and they still do. I'm not a doctor, but having been through the breast cancer mill, I now know the process from the inside out. And as a journalist, I'm used to interviewing experts and translating sometimes impenetrable medical advice, statistics and information in a way that's clear and useful for a wider audience. As well as being an emotional support, you'll find practical advice here for all the stages of treatment and further ways in which you can reduce your risk of recurrence. An estimated quarter of all breast cancer cases in the UK are preventable, and while no one can claim to prevent cancer completely, there are just too many varied causes, many of which are not yet fully understood. There are certainly steps that you can take to reduce your risk. I want you to be able to skip quickly to the part of this book that you most need right now. So it's broken down into 4 parts. Dip in and out as required. The idea is that if you're struggling with overwhelm, fatigue, and brain fog caused by cancer treatment and its side effects, you can go straight to what you need at that moment and ignore everything else. Part 1. Diagnosis. An introduction to the different types of breast cancer and the people you will meet as part of your medical team. It also covers advice about coming to terms with your diagnosis psychologically and what additional tools and resources are available to support you through treatment. Part 2. Treatment. The most practical chapter, taking each element of treatment in turn and explaining what you need to know. Everyone's experience is different, so whether you need chemotherapy, surgery, radiotherapy, hormonal therapy, targeted treatments, or all of the above, you can skip to the part most relevant for you. Part 3. The end of treatment and the myth of the all clear. Here I address post-treatment issues like menopausal symptoms and fear of recurrence, as well as a positive report on the future of cancer treatment. Then there's a guide to designing your new identity and stepping into your post-cancer life feeling renewed rather than decimated. It might not feel like it yet, but this is possible. If you are newly diagnosed, you might not want to listen to this section until you're closer to it, but it's here when you're ready. Part 4. Future-proofing your body. Once you've been through cancer treatment, I'm fairly certain you'll be keen to do anything and everything to avoid ever having to do it again. There are plenty of steps you can take to reduce your risk of recurrence, and new treatment breakthroughs are happening all the time. This is your guide. Throughout the book, I often refer to women because men account for less than 1% of breast cancer cases. But this can be a particularly difficult diagnosis for men who may feel a sense of shame about having what's considered a female type of cancer. If you're a man with breast cancer, the sections on hormonal issues and the menopause will not be so relevant, but hopefully you can still get a lot out of this book. In fact, if you don't have breast cancer but have a family history or a loved one going through it, you'll find much that's helpful here too. This book is for anyone whose life has been touched by breast cancer, and it's the book I wish I'd had by my bedside when I was diagnosed. I hope that it helps you. Part 1. Diagnosis. My story. In December 2020, cancer was the last thing on my mind. I had a busy, fun job as deputy editor of Grazia magazine. My husband Jonathan and I have two kids, Ezra and Eden, who were then 6 and 3, and we were busy with pre-Christmas deadlines and the usual festive stress that time of year can bring. So when I felt a lump on my right breast one day, I almost didn't go to the doctor. Since I'm now such an advocate of regular breast checking, I'm a bit embarrassed to admit that I did not routinely check my own breasts, and found the lump as a pure fluke while moisturising after a shower. According to Google, lumpy breasts are common, and only 1 in 10 lumps turns out to be cancer. It was Jonathan who nudged me to make sure I was going to call the surgery, and when the appointment time came, I was having second thoughts. "I can't even really feel it now," I muttered. "If I go, I'll be wasting the NHS's time during a pandemic." Oh yes, you might remember there was a pandemic on at that time. "Well, you've made the appointment now," replied Jonathan, "so you're wasting their time if you don't go." The doctor could certainly feel the lump. 2 days before Christmas, I was sitting in an East London breast clinic, replying to work emails and texting reassurances to Jonathan, in between being led into various rooms. First for a mammogram, then an ultrasound, and eventually a biopsy. Even then, I wasn't particularly concerned. Google assured me that 4 out of 5 breast biopsies come back benign. "People with cancer are tired and ill-looking," I reasoned to myself. I was a healthy 40-year-old, with neither the time nor the inclination to have cancer, thanks. If anything, I was just a bit frustrated at how long all this was taking. After all the tests, the nurse said that I had to see the doctor one last time before leaving, and I took a seat in his office as he nodded hello. The nurse also came into the room, and looking back, that should have been a clue that things were about to get more serious than I'd anticipated. This being the pandemic, we were all wearing blue surgical masks, so I couldn't see much of the doctor's face. He started explaining that biopsy results normally take a week, but because of Christmas and New Year, it would be 2 weeks. Of course, fine, I nodded. So, he continued, in January, we'll discuss whether to go straight to surgery or if you need to have chemotherapy first. Wait, what? I laughed awkwardly, but he didn't seem to be joking. But that's if it's cancer, I said slowly, which it might not be. We can tell from the ultrasound that it's very likely to be cancer, he said. How likely? 95%. The worst news of my life, delivered in a brutally casual way. Hot tears formed and were absorbed into my face covering. The nurse, perhaps feeling that the doctor's manner had been a bit brusque, ushered me into another room. She explained that breast lumps are given a cancer likelihood score out of 5, known as BI-RADS, for Breast Imaging and Reporting Data System. Mine was a 5, meaning the growth was highly likely to be malignant. I have seen people with a score of 5 get a benign biopsy result, she said. It does happen. Oh, right, okay, I sniffed. Well, a very small number, she backpedaled, realising she'd given me foundationless hope. In most cases, it is cancer. I called Jonathan as soon as I left the hospital, but perhaps due to shock, I only told him that I'd had a biopsy and would get the results in 2 weeks. I didn't mention what the doctor had said until I got home. By that point, I had pulled myself together, and we both agreed not to spiral into panic, at least until we knew for sure. It's an odd feeling being told a life-changing diagnosis is probably on the horizon, but not yet confirmed. The next 2 weeks passed in a daze of shell-shocked calm. Jonathan and I were torn between trying to come to terms with the cancer diagnosis and hoping that I'd be in the 5% of biopsies that turn out to be fine. We decided not to tell anyone before the biopsy result, which was actually easy, since COVID restrictions meant we weren't allowed to see anyone anyway. We didn't want to worry our families, particularly our children, until we really had to. So we opened Christmas presents, made a nut roast, and cheerily FaceTimed my mum, who lives in Scotland and was shielding with a chronic chest condition. When we became tearful, we blamed whichever Pixar movie we had just watched with the kids. On 6th of January, I was back in the breast clinic to receive the results. It was pretty clear that bad news was coming when, on the phone, they said I could bring someone with me. Thanks to COVID restrictions, this was one of only 2 or 3 times when I was allowed to have Jonathan in the room with me over the following months of tests, appointments, chemotherapy, and surgery. We're both pretty calm in a crisis, or maybe we were in shock, but we nodded politely as it was explained that yes, it is cancer. The surgeon, thankfully a different doctor to the short shrift one from before Christmas, said the cancer was triple negative. Having never heard of that before, I looked at him blankly before asking, is that a good thing or a bad thing? He shrugged. It's not really good or bad, it's just a type of breast cancer. There were 2 separate tumours in the breast, this is known as multifocal cancer, and the ultrasound had suggested lymph node involvement, which was quickly confirmed with another biopsy, so I would need 5 months of chemotherapy before I could have surgery. We were so dazed that we didn't ask many questions, but the one I do remember asking is, can I assure my kids that I'm not going to die? I cried with relief when the answer was yes. Looking back, this was before they had done the MRI, CT and bone scans to check that there was no cancer elsewhere in my body, so they can't have known that for sure, but I still feel grateful they said it. We were handed leaflets and told to expect appointment dates for all of those scans and the first of many oncological appointments. I wasn't to see a surgeon again until much closer to my surgery date in the summer. The next couple of hours were spent walking around a freezing park, calling my family and closest friends to let them know. I started each conversation with a jaunty, "So I've got some news that sounds bad, but it's going to be fine." My mum lives alone and had lost her sister to ovarian cancer only a few months earlier, so I arranged for a local friend to pop by for a doorstep chat with her immediately after I broke the news. Being 400 miles away, it was hard that I couldn't hug her. But because of the restrictions, I wasn't even allowed to hug my friend who lives around the corner. It's one of many reasons why I felt so grateful to have Jonathan and the kids during the following year. I can't imagine what it must have been like for people who live alone dealing with a cancer diagnosis during the pandemic. I understand that many people make the decision to keep their diagnosis quiet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.